Hi, and welcome to this introduction to Twin 3 from FabFilter. Twin 3 is the latest iteration of the FabFilter synthesizer plugin, with many significant improvements over its predecessor, and I'll be taking you through some of the new features in this video. Some of you may be thinking, however, that yet another subtractive synth isn't much to get excited about these days. I'm going to offer a few possible reasons you might get a bit excited, but I'm going to save the most important one for last, so stick around till the end. Let's start with presets. Of course, we have a whole load of new presets, carefully tuned by expert sound designers. We also have a new preset browser, however, with the ability to tag favorites and explanatory comments. Twin 3 can also load Twin 2 presets, so you can continue to use old favorites, like this epic piano from B-Manic. But the really great thing about subtractive synthesis, in my own opinion, is that it's quite easy and intuitive, and it's not that hard to learn how to dial in some simple sounds. And with subtractive synthesis, simple patches can often sound great. In fact, in the context of a mix, the simpler sounds are often more useful. Let's start with just a square wave oscillator and no filtering. We have new and improved oscillators in Twin 3 with modelled analog-style drift, plus a new pure square wave shape in case you want a more perfect set of odd harmonics. Of course, we can adjust the pulse width. And the sound of the pulse width changing is kind of magic. So let's modulate that parameter with a slow triangle wave. This is one of those sounds that's never going to get old, especially when spiced up with a bit of delay and reverb. Let's add some portamento or glide as well, so that notes slide to new pitches instead of jumping instantly. Lovely. Okay, let's turn off oscillator 1 for now and add another. Let's have a sawtooth wave this time. And I'll turn up the sync knob. This gives us classic oscillator sync sounds, as if we had two oscillators with one synced to the other. But we only need one oscillator in Twin 3. Let's modulate the sync knob with the same slow triangle LFO we used earlier. And there's another classic, timeless sound that's never going to get boring. This one can work well with other wave shapes as well. The square waves are similar, but with a more hollow, odd harmonics only character. But the sine and triangles can also sound interesting, with higher harmonics appearing and disappearing as the virtual synced oscillator sweeps in pitch and hits different musical intervals. I'm going to go with the more aggressive sounding sawtooth, however. And let's try it together with that pulse width modulated square from oscillator 1, with oscillator 2 tuned up an octave. That sounds nice and fat. So let's try duplicating this sound with three detuned voices. And that's even fatter still. I wonder what eight voices sounds like. Awesome is the answer. What about 16? It just keeps getting fatter. Sod it, let's try 64. In all honesty, this example was supposed to demonstrate that the optimum number of voices is usually only a handful, sometimes no more than two, but I guess there's always an exception. A couple of things I feel like pointing out here. First, this spread parameter that controls the detuning of all 64 voices. Well, you can modulate that, you know. Let's link this LFO I prepared earlier, and the voices now periodically spread apart, then drift back into unison. The filter section can be useful even when you don't need traditional filters, as it now includes all the usual EQ options as well. Here's a low shelf. This can be clean, just like a low shelf in Pro Q3, or saturated with all the same colour options as the main filters, which I'll come to shortly. And of course, they can be modulated in many different ways. Drag a connection to the filter node to modulate filter cutoff, or hover to show other modulatable parameters like peak or resonance, which in this case controls the low shelf gain. If I invert this modulation, I'm now ducking the low frequencies with an envelope, which is keyed from the sidechain input, to which I have inevitably routed my kick drum. Also, the CPU use is still very modest, even with 64x2 oscillators running. Ah, but what about the high quality mode at the bottom? This adds 8x oversampling, which is surely going to be too hungry with 64 voices. But in fact, no, it still runs fine, even on my ancient processor. Though of course the CPU load does go up noticeably. Does it sound a bit better now? Perhaps a little. Actually, the oscillators already produce very little aliasing, even without the high quality option. This setting becomes more important if I increase the LFO rate. This goes well into the audio range, right up to 500 Hz. And the oversampling makes a big difference in that case. Okay, let's talk about the filters. There's another of those simple things that just sounds great, especially with a nice stereo delay. This is the classic filter style, which can trace its heritage right back to the first ever FabFilter plugin. But this is an updated algorithm with better saturation, reduced aliasing, and a generally better sound. Now compare that with the tube style. Or perhaps the extreme style. Each filter style is very different and will respond quite differently, especially with lots of resonance. Here's a naive snare drum, just white noise through a high-pass filter. Notice how dramatically the sound changes as I switch filter type. The classic style is too crunchy and distorted sounding in this case. Tube is nice if I bump up the resonance a bit with the global knob to the right. But when I want a powerful, low resonance, I usually get best results from the metal style or the hollow style. Let's double-click over to the right to add a low-pass filter, because I don't really want the noise to keep going above about 10k or so. But a resonant boost around there can often be useful to add a crisp top end. Again, the classic style is too crunchy. I'm quite fond of the hard filter for adding crispy top end. Now let's add some reverb. That's longer than I want, but we can tweak that. Don't worry, I will show you some long ambient settings later on. But for now, notice how effectively it can do small room type settings that just add a little space without drawing any attention. Another example. Here's a pulse wave plus some noise running through a tuned bandpass filter for a kind of flute panpipe sort of effect. And notice how different the filter types sound in this case. Okay, here's a simple new feature that makes a big quality of life difference. Here's the LFO driving the vibrato. If I click the node, we can see that I've linked it to three parameters: the pulse oscillator's pitch, the filter cutoff, as that's essentially acting as an oscillator in this patch, and also the master volume, because with wind instruments, vibrato tends to be as much about amplitude modulation as pitch modulation. The new feature I refer to is the little ring around the node, which acts as a master control for the whole LFO. Turn this up for more modulation of all linked parameters, or down for less, or down below zero to invert the modulation. Best of all, this parameter can itself be modulated. Let's set it to zero, then link the mod wheel so I can introduce vibrato in the traditional way. You could achieve the same result before by modulating each of the three assignments individually with the mod wheel, but the new method will be quicker and easier in many cases, and is available with all the other modulators as well, such as the envelopes or envelope followers. Speaking of envelopes, you can reuse the main amplitude envelope for other parameters as well by dragging from the node at the bottom. I'm going to link this to the reverb mix knob and invert it. Then do the same for the delay. And the effects are now ducked down for each note, then fade back up again in between. Okay, here's a raw sawtooth. I'm going to add another oscillator with another sawtooth tuned to the same register, but four semitones higher, which of course gives us a major third interval. Except it's not really a major third. It's the equal tempered approximation of a major third, which is actually off by a whole 13 cents. Notice how different it sounds if I adjust the tuning to produce a just major third with a perfect 5-4 frequency ratio. Toggling between just and equal tempered versions with raw saw waves like this can be quite an eye-opener. We've grown accustomed in the West to this out-of-tune, rather agitated and unsettled version of a major third. But we've arguably lost the purity and power of those super consonant pure intervals in the pursuit of greater freedom to modulate between different keys and use more adventurous harmony. Okay, let's delete that second oscillator. And this time I'll play a C major chord instead of just a single note. There's that out-of-tune, equal-tempered major third again. And strictly speaking, the fifth is slightly out as well, though it's a lot closer. We can fix that now, however, as Twin 3 supports Scala tune files. A few of these are provided, so let's load up the C major just tuning. And now we have a perfect C major triad with all the correct frequency ratios, 3-2 between the fifth and the root, and 5-4 between the major third and the root. But you'll note that there's a different just tuning for C minor, because unlike equal temperament, the key you're playing in makes a big difference. You'll find that some chords sound much more in tune and consonant than the equal tempered versions. While other chords, even some that would normally be considered to be within the diatonic key of C minor, sound noticeably out of tune. Honestly, microtonal tuning is quite a deep rabbit hole full of maths and music history, and most people who dive into it do so to more authentically recreate period Western music, or to work in non-Western styles with different tuning systems. Here's the bundled Shruti scale, for example. I did try to compose a piece of music using this temperament, but I was way too far out of my comfort zone, and I gave up pretty quickly. But I do think there's scope for this to be used in musical styles that rely on powerful sawtooth chord beds. These chords are so much more powerful when tuned to just intervals. Of course, if I add multiple detuned sawtooth waves, arguably the difference becomes much less important. But that detuning knob can be automated or modulated. I'm going to link it to my mod wheel. And now I have a really big contrast available between lush, rich detuning and hard, powerful, pure intervals. I should also note, I suspect many producers already do this without realizing by tuning oscillators by ear and creating one-finger chord presets in their synthesizers. That's also a valid option. While we've got this preset up, I'm going to use it to demonstrate the phaser effect. We just get a mix knob up front, but you can click the middle to pop up some extra parameters, including modulation rate and depth. Feedback, which can go negative as well. And shift, which seems to offset the phase of the modulation for one channel. Alternatively, you might prefer to have a flanger with all the same options. Okay, here's a simple musical device that often works well. You don't need to know that this is a polymeter or know the difference between that and a polyrhythm. You just need to enable the arpeggiator and play a three-note chord over a 4/4 beat. One important point about FabFilter Tempo Sync, however, you can still offset it by an arbitrary amount if you want. So if you want a polyrhythm, you can type in the appropriate fraction. 1.25 gives 5 against 4, for example. Let's go back to the grid timing, however, because that way the groove control makes sense. Drag it to the right to add a swing feel. And feel free to set the note length to taste. We also get the expected options to repeat the pattern up one or two octaves. And options for up, down, random note order. Here's a pretty standard arpeggiator feature that often goes overlooked, however. The as played option allows you to define the order of notes for each chord by the order in which they were played. You can control this manually while playing by deliberately playing little arpeggios instead of block chords. Or you can play block chords and get a pseudo-random effect from your natural timing inconsistencies. But you can also combine this with one of the latch modes for more fun. The full latch will hold every chord and keep the arpeggio cycling until you play another chord, which might make you think you've got stuck notes if you forget it's turned on. But the held latch holds your chord for as long as any one note is held. This means you can, in effect, build up little step sequences in real time by holding one note and then adding the rest in the order you want. And this can be a lot of fun to play with in real time. So let's spice up this preset a little bit. I'll add an XLFO, configured as a step sequencer. Then I'll use this to modulate the sustain parameter of the filter envelope. Let's turn that modulation up most of the way. And let's also use the same sequence to modulate the portamento. But not by that much. Let's also have some delay, which I'll set to a triplet timing. Note that again, you're not limited to pure tempo synced divisions. I often like to offset delay times fractionally to spread out repeats and stop them stacking up in an ugly way. And you can also offset the left and right timings for a stereo effect, or switch to a ping pong mode if you want. Notice also we get another four filters for the feedback path, with all the same filter types available, so a huge range of different colours are available. Let's also have some distortion. This can be subtle saturation, or more obvious crunch, or utterly filthy, depending how you set the knob. This is the only effect that lacks a pop-up panel with more parameters, but you can switch it to run pre-effects for a slightly cleaner, more controlled result. Or post-effects, so delay repeats start to intermodulate with the dry signal and things start to get more chaotic. Of course, Twin 3 presets don't have to be simple. Here's a setup with four oscillators, because we can do that now, plus four filters. And the filters are set to run in per oscillator mode, rather than series or parallel. So oscillator 1 feeds filter 1, and so on. If we listen to them one by one, oscillator 1 is a sawtooth wave through a modulated low-pass filter. Oscillator 2 is a slowly width-modulated pulse wave through a high-pass filter. Oscillator 3 is just noise running through a tuned resonant filter. And oscillator 4 uses oscillator sync, with a filter modulated by an LFO, which is in turn modulated by another LFO. Putting these all in together gets a bit messy and confused, in all honesty. So I'm going to switch to the new per oscillator mode instead. Now the first note I play triggers oscillator 1, the second oscillator 2, and so on. Which can be a great way to emulate the inconsistencies between oscillators in a vintage polysynth, or to create complex and interesting pad sounds like this one. This patch will obviously benefit from some added delay. And let's take a look at the reverb as well. I'll set it fully wet, so we can listen to just the reverb for now. And for a pad sound like this, I feel like maxing out the reverb time. There are only three parameters here, which might seem a bit limiting, but in fact there are a lot more possibilities than it seems at first. Notice first what a wide range the brightness control covers, all the way from super dark and boomy, up to shimmery and ethereal. And now consider that this parameter can be modulated in the same way as any of the synth parameters. Let's use a slowly sweeping LFO to make the reverb swell from dark to bright and back again. The pre-delay slider below would usually be used to delay the reverb slightly relative to the dry signal, which helps to stop the part being pushed into the background. Obviously, that only works when there's some dry signal mixed in, but modulating this parameter makes it much more exciting. Now we get interesting pitch modulation or chorusing effects, and a much richer and more characterful reverb tail. Okay, let's put a bit of the dry signal back in, and I'll round out this preset with a touch of drive, just for subtle saturation this time, rather than obvious distortion. Right, I promised to give you a good reason to get excited, so here it is. The best thing about subtractive synthesis, in my opinion, is that it's easy and intuitive enough to allow for sound design to become part of the production process. And Twin 3 is arguably a candidate for best subtractive synth to use in the heat of a production. It's probably not going to limit you with a lack of modulation options, but neither will it overwhelm you with a huge and complex mod matrix when you're just trying to set up something simple. It doesn't stick to the limited feature set of a classic famous synth, as many plugins in this category do, but it does provide their ability to just sound good with minimal effort. For example, sometimes the ideal bass sound for a production will just be two sine waves. Here's one, tuned an octave higher than you might expect. And another tuned a fifth higher again. But when they're both in together, they trick our ears into hearing a phantom low fundamental that's not really there. It's a lot quicker to throw this patch together on the fly than it would be to browse the bass preset category for something suitable. And the best part is, you can then tune it and refine it in context with the production it needs to fit in. Does it need another oscillator, up another octave, to give it more mid-range definition? Does it have the right dynamic shape? Making those decisions in context with your mix allows you to craft sounds that fit together well right off the bat, take less effort to mix, and will often result in a better overall production, in my experience. It's well worth the small effort to learn the most common subtractive synthesis techniques so you can start to build these bread and butter sounds from scratch rather than always preset hunting. Okay, that's all for now. Thanks for watching.